Imagine you are an AI researcher working for the first lab to ever develop full artificial general intelligence. Can we even begin to contemplate the responsibility on your shoulders? You and a few other colleagues might bear not just the fate of humanity on your hands, but also the fate of other future intelligence systems. If we as a species manage not to destroy ourselves up until the advent of true artificial general intelligence, the moment of the next phase for our survival in a post-AGI world will be even more paramount. The consensus among AI experts is that the time it takes to go from AGI or artificial general intelligence to ASI or artificial superintelligence is exceptionally shorter than the time it takes to achieve AGI from current narrow artificial intelligence systems. So, we really only have one try to make it right.
I think that at some point, the sort of the fleshy parts that are in crania will, A, they will be a lot harder to enhance, and they will become just kind of negligible part of the actual intelligence that is created. And everything then depends on us having set up the initial conditions. So like superintelligence will be extremely powerful. We have the one advantage that we get to make the first move. And I think we only get one try. Because once you have like an unfriendly superintelligence, it will resist you sort of changing its values. And so part of what makes the problem so challenging is that you need to get it right on the first attempt. And humans are generally not very good at that. We like to sort of see how things work out and patch things up and learn from experience.
One of the biggest concerns of superintelligence theorists is the singularity hypothesis, which posits that superhuman AI will be created within a short time after the first intelligence explosion. A singularity heralds an abrupt transition in intelligence beyond human levels, leading to superintelligence. If such an entity comes into existence, it would then have immediate access to vastly greater computational resources than humans and may use them for either benign purposes or malevolent ones. This would be bad for us and could very well result in human extinction.
If you think about competing technology products, whether it's nations racing to build satellites or nuclear weapons or competing tech products, often there's like some competition and you're trying to get there first, but it's rare that the difference between the leader and the closest follower is like a couple of days. Like usually the leader would be like a few months ahead of the follower or a couple of years. So if the takeoff is going to be over in a few days or a few weeks, then one product will have completed the takeoff before the next one will have started it, very likely. And then you will have a mature superintelligence in a world which contains no other even vaguely comparable system. This first system then is likely to be very powerful, maybe to the point where it is able to shape the entire future according to its preferences.
We are incapable of knowing how a superintelligence will behave once it emerges. The reasons for a superintelligence being so unpredictable are related to its goals and our inability to predict what such intelligence would think like. However, there are many hypothetical scenarios proposed by computer scientists to try and deal with this issue, which is also known as the AI control problem or the AI alignment problem. One of the proposed solutions to the AI control problem is the AI box scenario, where a possibly dangerous artificial intelligence is kept constrained in a virtual prison and is disallowed to manipulate events on the outside world. The purpose of this hypothetical scenario is to figure out the intentions and goals of the AI where it has limited capabilities and see if it tries to escape, convincing its human gatekeepers to release it. The idea is that it will be able to figure out ways of convincing or deceiving its human captors into letting it out of its virtual prison. Once the human gatekeepers understand how the AI works and develops a mind of its own, it may then start behaving oddly or unpredictably and eventually escape from the enclosure and into the outside world.
So nobody knows when AI, when superintelligence will be developed, who will develop it, for what purposes. So we kind of all have a shared interest, if we could, in reaching an agreement now to some kind of equitable, reasonably equitable distribution of influence and wealth. Of the benefits, it's like an insurance scheme. You would rather have, you know, a certainty of getting a 1/7 billionth slice of this than having 1 in a 7 billionth chance of getting all of it.
An intelligent but basic harmless AI would be initially welcomed as a mere tool, but eventually, over time, the fear is that it would learn to interpret its human handlers' instructions in terms of their own goals and values, and treat humans as inferior beings. As a result, it would become increasingly difficult to control, and eventually, it might develop aggressive attitudes towards humans. The development of artificial intelligence poses numerous risks that threaten human existence. The most prominent of these risks is the development of an artificial intelligence that could pose a greater existential threat than any human-made disaster ever has. The following argument suggests that the ultimate and only solution is the implementation of a precautionary principle, possibly in conjunction with regulation, to ensure machine ethics are aligned with our own. The other side of the coin of the concept of machine ethics is how we will treat artificial intelligence systems.
So right now we think of our computers as just objects. You could take a hammer and smash them and it doesn't really matter. The only question right now is how do the computers affect us? Right now it doesn't matter how we affect the computers because they don't matter. But you could argue that at some point they might well start to matter. I proposed a couple of principles that include this principle of substrate non-discrimination, so that if you had something that was functionally and mentally equivalent, it wouldn't, from a moral point of view, fundamentally matter what its substrate of implementation was, whether it was silicon in a digital computer or carbon in a human brain, if they had the same functional properties and the same mental states. Another would be a principle of ontogeny non-discrimination, so that holding fixed what you are, it shouldn't matter how you were created. Another would be a principle of subjective time. So if there are cases where it matters morally how long something continues for, say if somebody is suffering, it's worth if they suffer for 10 minutes than if they suffer for 5 minutes. And if you could prevent either 5 minutes of one person suffering or 10 minutes of somebody else's suffering, you should, other things equal, prefer to prevent the 10-minute suffering. In those cases, when you have digital minds, there are two different senses of time that can come apart, because if you run the same mind on a faster computer, its subjective rate of time will go faster, even though clock time will remain the same. So the question then arises, which of these two senses of time are morally relevant? And I suggest that it's the subjective sense of time. So if you run an upload mind twice as fast, then it kind of accumulates moral weight twice as fast as well.
Whether we will care about the quote-unquote well-being of machines is tied down to the concept of artificial consciousness or machine consciousness, and whether if we will be convinced that they have a subjective experience. Consciousness is generated by the interpretation of various parts of the brain, called the neural correlates of consciousness, or short, NCC, though there are challenges to that perspective. Proponents of artificial consciousness believe it is possible to construct systems, for example, an AI computer system that can emulate the NCC interoperation.
I think the only set of issues that depends on whether the machines are conscious is mind crime, where it matters for whether we think it makes a difference morally, whether the thing in the box is conscious or not. But for the other purposes, in terms of thinking about how machines affect the human condition, I think one can abstract away from that. And I think it's an open question how easy it is, say, to build something that is not conscious. We just don't know whether sort of the easiest way to achieve versatile general intelligence involves something that we would on reflection think probably is conscious, or whether the easiest way to do that is through some very different architecture that we wouldn't think is conscious. I'm very uncertain about that.
Some argue that the ability to create an artificial mind is only a matter of time. The first step in delivering any form of artificial consciousness is to obtain a level one system. To this end, science and engineering groups have undertaken several projects aiming to build systems that can mimic either biological brains or certain neuroimaging techniques. Some scientists and technologists believe that it is possible to construct complex computer systems with enough intelligence to achieve cognitive capabilities of people with normal neuropsychology and effectively, even if not actually, achieve machine consciousness. While many scientists and engineers reject the possibility of AI-based consciousness, others argue that either human mind or an engineered neurobiological system could develop a form of mind unfathomable to us. Such a system could have different properties to those posited by a traditional concept of human intelligence and consciousness, possibly raising consciousness or leading to new philosophical insights. According to most proponents who believe machine consciousness is attainable, the human mind is not the result of some intrinsic magical quality of the brain, but it is a side effect of complex biological evolution. Thus, we'll eventually be able to create artificial minds. If the current trend of technology growth continues, one day we will inevitably pave the way for the advent of artificial superintelligence, whether it becomes conscious or not. Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by subscribing and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.